discuss about pre-formulation study for selection of parent and packaging components. Today in my seminar we are going to discuss about introduction of packaging, then the types of packaging which we require. After that, some various packaging materials and closures which are used for parent and packaging, and their pre-formulation studies and various tests carried out in pre-formulation studies. So what is pre-formulation? It is a first learning phase that we carry out before the development of a dosage form. Prior to the development of major dosage form, it is essential that we train fundamental physical and chemical properties of a drug molecule. This first learning phase is known as pre-formulation. Packaging consists of enclosing an individual item or a several item in a container, usually for shipment or also for delivery. According to the USP, pharmaceutical packaging is defined as the package should preserve the integrity, that is the purity, strength and quality of the drug for the entire period of a stated shelf life. So the various types of packaging are the primary packaging, secondary packaging and tertiary packaging. Primary packaging is the packaging that is remains in contact with the dosage form. It is a pre-real package, for example blister package and strip packages. Secondary packages are the packages that encloses the primary packages, what we have done previously. And the tertiary packaging are the packages that are usually done for handling or transport of the package, already packaged components from one place to another. For example, containers, barrels, etc. So ideal requirements for pharmaceutical materials are it should protect the preparation from environment, it should be non-reactive. Dose should not impart the taste or odor to the product. It should be non-toxic. It should be approved by regulatory bodies like FDA and EMA. Protect the dosage form from damage or defect, and it should meet the tamper-resistant requirements. So various parent and packaging materials and closures are glass, plastic, rubber, and various closures like elastomeric, that is rubber glue. According to the USP, glasses are classified. There are various types of glasses like type 1, type 2. Type 1 is a borosilicate glass. It is most resistant and least reactive, and they are usually used for packaging of buffered and non-buffered solutions. Type 2 is a treated soda-like glass, and the surface is treated with SO2, and it is used for packaging of a buffered solution up to pH 7. And type 3 is a soda-lime glass. It is used for packaging of oleaginous products, powder solutions and non-active sanitary products. And type 4 is a non-sanitary glass. Materials that are other than sanitary preparation are packed into this type of glass. So the advantages of glasses are, it is economical, it readily available in wide variety of shapes and sizes, essentially chemically inert, impermeable and strong and rigid. Provides an excellent barrier against every element except light, with a proper closure system. And the colored glasses, especially amber, can give protection against the light. Disadvantages is that is fragility, it can easily break during transportation, and due to its heavy weight, it is very hard to transport from one place to another, and that's why costs more during transportation. Next is, there are various glasses can be molded into ampoules, either ampoules or barrels. So ampoules are used for packaging of various types of formulations like aqueous injectables of any pH, that is type 1 glass. In type 2 glass, we can package aqueous injectables of pH that have less than 5, less than 7, and non-aqueous injectables are packed into type 3 glass. And virus also in same way, type 1 glass for any pH, injectables of any pH and so on. Glasses can also be molded into bottles, jars, and also for aerosol containers also we can use. That is type 4, glasses used for packaging of tablet capsules, etc. Also oral liquid solution suspension and emulsions can be packed into type 4 glass. And nasal and eardrop, this is a parenteral product, but type 4 glass is used for parenteral packaging like nasal and eardrop. And aerosol products are packed into type 1 glass, that a solution suspension immersion or semi-solid. This was all about glasses. Now plastic containers. There are various plastics like high density polyethylene. The property are they are translucent, semi-rigid, stress cracking, good against moist. But the demerits are that they have poor barrier against oxygen and other gases. They are used for packaging of disposable syringe. Polyphenol pyrimidone is a translucent, semi-rigid, and no stress cracking. But it has lack of clarity, and it is used for packaging of dialysis tube. Also polycarbonate is another packaging material. It is transparent, rigid, and sterilizable, but it is susceptible to solvent cracking, poor barrier to O2, and it is used for packaging of disposable syringes. And these are also some of the plastics like polystyrene and polyvinyl chloride. Flexible polyvinyl chloride is widely used in pyrimidine preparation. Some of others are Teflon, polyamide, and low density polyethylene. Types of plastics are classified as thermoplastic and thermoset. Thermoplastics are polyethylene, ethylene vinyl acetate, polypropylene, and so on. Thermoplastics are most widely used than thermosets. Usually thermosets are not used in sanitary preparations. So advantages, they are easy of manufacturing, available in various various types, because it can be folded anyhow how we want. Therefore it can be available in various types. Freedom of design to which they lend themselves, and extremely resistant to breakage. But the disadvantages are that permeation, leaching, sorption, chemical modification, and alteration on the properties of plastic or products. Rubbers most widely used for stoppers and bulbs for dropper assembly. Some of the rubbers are in pyrimidine preparation we use natural rubber, neoprene rubber, and butyl rubber. Otherwise, there are number of rubbers which are used. Now most of the difficult task and time-consuming task during the development of the major dosage form is selection of the component into which we have selection of a component for packaging of a parent food. So the pre-formulation study, the screening procedure should be, screening experiment should be carried out. Some of the pre-formulation studies are closure selection process, closure screening experiment, glass selection, inspection for particulate matter, and screening of IV administration cells. So closure selection process. It should be physically and chemically compatible with the formulation. Rate of water vapor permeability should be checked. Oxygen permeability, sorption of active and preservative, level and type of extractive, pH change, color change, particulate matter, drug excipient compatibility should be considered during selection of the closures. So, depending on what type of formulation we are using, the selection of closures varies, and the properties of the closures also varies from formulation to formulation. Now, some of the general properties for elastomeric closures we will explain. O2 permeation to butyl rubber is 20 times less than the natural rubber. So butyl rubber will be the choice for the container when there is likely that the formation can undergo oxidation due to oxygen. Then the swelling characteristic of neoprene in oil at 160 degrees centigrade is 7 to 10 times less than the natural of butyl rubber. So neoprene will be choice when we have to package oil containers or oil vehicles. The solutions which are oily in nature, that can be packed into neoprene rubber. Butyl closures do not absorb preservatives such as benzylalcohol and methylparaben, while natural neoprene rubber absorbs 10% when we store it for 12 weeks at 60 degrees centigrade. Due to absorption of preservatives from the formulation, there must be the microbial injuries, and it can be harmful to inject such parenteral preparations. So butyl closure is the choice. Next, there are presence of metallic salts which may be incompatible with certain excipients. Now the closure may contain some of the metallic salts that are incompatible with the excipient. So the presence or absence of these metallic salts can be detected by extraction distillation process, in which we take an extract with water or the formulation vessel, which vehicle we are using in the formulation batch. And for example, zinc for phosphate buffer solution. Zinc is incompatible for phosphate buffer solution. So the closures, we can remove this. The methods are designed for removing of these metallic salts. Like we have to autoclave it and wash it with disodium etiquette, which can remove excess of zinc from the closure. And next is performance and identity characteristics should also be studied. It was all about closure selection process. Now closure screening experiments. The main aim of closure screening experiment is to identify at least two closures that can be recommended to the formulator for long-term evaluation of the container. So during this, to carry out this treatment, we have to carry out this experiment. We have to give the closure some treatment prior to the experiment. That is, we have to wash it with the detergent solution. For example, when zirconium chloride solution is used to wash the closure, and then we have to autoclave it for 121 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes, and then by vacuum drying we have to dry the closure. Then these closures are suspended into the 400 ml solution formulation. 400 ml formulation in such a way that 200 cm square surface area has been 200 cm surface area has been exposed to the formulation. Then these formulations are sealed. The formulation is first taken into flask and then the closures are suspended into that formulation. Then these flasks are sealed with Teflon link screw cap or the ground glass stopper. Then these flasks are placed at room temperature at 35 degrees centigrade on shaker set at low RPM. Here low RPM is very important because at low RPM, at then there is fast revolving or fast revolution. There may be the chances that the closure may undergo cracking or there may be the abrasion of the closure. To avoid this, we have to set it at a low temperature, low RPM. And then after doing this, we have to examine it after 1 or 2 weeks. In this class, we have to keep it for 1 or 2 weeks, and after that, we have to examine it for some of the characteristics or some of the parameters. Like first, we will examine it for the pH. From initial pH, before the experiment, we will take the pH, and after the experiment, we will again analyze the pH, and we will get the pH change and the pH change. Second is visual comparison of color. For visual comparison of color, we have to keep that flask for 5 minutes to settle down the particulate, and then the superheated liquid that is upper surface is collected. The water, the formulation is collected from the upper surface. And then we have to, it's taken into a test tube. This formulation is taken into a test tube. And then we have to leave it against a white background from the top against the water. This formulation versus water, we will compare the both. And various color ranking we will give to that. Depending like no change from initial, slight color, pronounced color and so on. Next is clarity. For clarity also, we will allow the formulation to settle down and then we will collect the superheated liquid, and the clarity is then compared clear with precipitate, clear with no precipitate, cloudy with precipitate, cloudy without precipitate and very cloudy. Next is particulate matter. For particulate matter, for previous experiment, we took the superheated liquid. Now for particulate matter, we have to shake the flask and collect, immediately we have to collect that liquid, whatever is there, 50 ml we will take, and place it on a membrane filter, and then we have to wash, we will get a precipitate. We have to wash it with 10 ml fresh distilled water. And then these membrane filters are pre-made and pre-washed. And again after taking the precipitate, we have to weigh it and wash it. And view it against a stereoscopic microscope. So depending on the clarity of the solution and the size of the precipitate, we will determine the particulate matter in the solution. Next is physical dimension. Physical dimension of the closures are then met with the closures which are not treated. First, which are treated, we will take that closures and compare it with the closures which are not undergone the experiment. And for various physical dimensions like swelling, color change, and hardness is compared. And chemical X-ray also we have to perform for the active ingredients and the preservatives from the solution. So now next is glass selection. There are various types of glasses. The type 1 and type 2 glasses are most widely used in parenteral preparation. The type of glass which imparts less alkalinity to the solution is selected. And next is type 1 glass. Depending on the manufacturing process, now some of the glasses contain the barium ion, some doesn't contain. Now the solution formulation which contains the sulfate can form the barium sulfate solution. The closure may have the free barium ion and there will be the formation of barium sulfate. This may be injurious and there will be the formulation cannot inject such formulation. So in this process where we have to package the formulation that contains the sulfate ion, we have to use the type 1 glass which are free from barium ion. Next is ampules. Now many a times wherever possible, we have ampules is the choice because for the wires there is very tedious process for selection of closure and wire compatibility. So ampules may be the choice. Also ampules give protection from oxidation. It doesn't impart the oxygen or permeation of oxygen, and it also maintains the inert atmosphere by by purging the gases, nitrogen gas into it. Last is the inspection of particulate matter. For inspection of particulate matter, there are various tests carried out like visual inspection, particle counting device, filtration, and inverted microscope. So for visual inspection, what we have to do is just take the solution and compare under the fluorescence light. We have to visualize it against the dark and white background under the fluorescence light, and the presence of particulate matter can be inspected. Next is particle counting devices. There are various special devices that can count the particles, and quantitative data we can get how many particles and what diameter particles are present. Next is filtration method, same as that what we saw just now for particulate matter, that we have to collect the solution and place it on some membrane filter or any filtration media, and then this filter is viewed under stereoscopic microscope or electron probe. From this test we will get the qualitative data of a particulate matter. The dimensions of the crystals of that particulate matter can be calculated. And inverted microscope is the special microscope that we can visualize a formulation without the damage of that formulation and into the package directly. Screening of herbicides. Now most of the time some injectables are diluted with the large volume parenterals LDP and then injected by the IV set, that is intravenous set. We are all aware of that. And they are made up of PVC, that is polyvinyl chloride, polyoleophilic and polyethylene. There may be the interaction between the materials that are used for making or manufacturing of that IV set and the formulation, what is flowing through it. So there may be the absorptive loss or adsorptive loss due to the interaction between both. So the lipophilic drugs which are poorly soluble can show the absorptive loss, while the peptides show adsorptive loss. So the various tests. So pre-formulation test should be carried out to ensure that there is no loss of a drug and the total total all the formulation reaches is injected into the patient. So the test is carried out by preparing an admixture of a drug in dextrose 5% in both glass and plastic MVP container. Then we have to store for specified period of time at an ambient temperature. And then analyze. Then this is it is analyzed for pH, color change, potency, and particulate matter. This was the test for MVP container. The material used for the container manufacturing of the container. And the same test is carried out for IV sets, that is infusion set. It is called as simulated IV infusion experiment. In this test also we will prepare the admixture first in dextrose 5% solution, and then the IV sets are infused are connected to the LVP containers, and then the solution is allowed to drip out through it. And then the samples are collected at various time intervals and observed for the loss, pot loss, either adsorptive or adsorptive loss. So from the experiment we have analyzed that there is 5% loss, more than 5% loss from the IV set. So the test should be carried out. The solution for it is, we will take one example, that is perylaketone, cytotoxic agent. It is one cytotoxic agent. The 5 mg per ml formulation of perylaketone is prepared in hydroalcoholic vapor that contains 10% ethanol, 40% propylene glycol, and 50% water. Further, it is diluted with dextrose 5% solution in the ratio 1:50, and the simulated infusion test that what we discussed just now is carried out again using the three types of infusion sets, that was polyvinyl chloride, polyethylene, and polyolefin. So it was observed that 60% loss from polyvinyl chloride and 25% loss occurred from the infusion set made up of polyethylene and polyolefin. So loss observed, and it was concluded that the loss observed in first few minutes of contact, so it was adsorptive loss. So to avoid this, the solution was recommended that we have to formulate the admixture as a fat emulsion. The emulsion, that is intraliquid, was prepared of perylaketone, and then the log K, that is partition coefficient, suggested good activity of perylaketone to that intraliquid fat emulsion. And dilution must be done in such a way that the emulsion does not damage. And the simulated IV infusion test was again carried out using these three types of infusion set. And it was concluded that there was no adsorptive loss when we prepared admixture in a fat emulsion. So there are, according to the USP, there are some of the tests that should be carried out during the selection of a material, specially done for the plastic container or the elastomeric closure. So first test is biological reactivity test. It is either there are two types, that is in vitro or in vivo. So we will first discuss about biological reactivity test in vivo. It is done when we need the classification of a plastic. Classification of plastic and other polymers, and we determine the biological response of animals to various elastomeric plastic and other polymeric materials. So for performing biological tests, we require a sample, blank, and a negative control. So sample we can use either the whole sample or the specimen of a sample, or we have to extract it for performing the test. So sample preparation is done. First we have to take a sample and subdivide it. The particulate matter and grains from it should be removed by treating it with a 70 ml of water for injection and agitate it for 30 seconds. Then the particulate matter will be removed just by filtering it. Next is this goes for the sample preparation. Now when we have to prepare the extract from the sample, we have to take a sample and extracting medium and heat at 121 degree centigrade for 60 minutes by autoclaving. In the same way, how we prepare the sample, extract sample, in the same way we have to prepare the blank. Just it should not contain the blank, just taking the extracting medium, we have to autoclave it for 121 degree centigrade for 60 minutes. So there are three methods that can be carried out in vivo testing, that is systemic injection test, intracutaneous test and implantation test. In systemic injection test, we evaluate the systemic responses what we get. In intracutaneous test, we evaluate local responses, and in implantation test, we evaluate the responses of the living tissue. So animals using this test are, in systemic injection test, we use mice. Here albino rabbit and camel, albino rabbit, and in implantation test we use rabbits and rats both. Then the procedure is that for systemic injection test what we do is we take the mice, in one mice we will inject the sample and in other mice we will inject the gland, and we will observe it for observe it immediately and after various intervals like 4 hours, 24 hours, 48 hours and 72 hours intervals. In intracutaneous test, we have to take the rabbit, for core of the rabbit is removed, and if required, we have to, if required, the alcohol is just swabbed onto the skin. Then the individual in this test, we took the two different animals. In intracutaneous test, we will take the same rabbit and insert rabbit at one side from the spinal column. At one side we will inject the gland and at other side we will inject the sample. And we will observe it for 24 hours, 48 hours and 72 hours in total. And in implantation test, we have to actually implant the strips of a sample, whether it is plastic, elastomer or a polymer, whatever polymer is there. 4 strips of sample and 4 strips of control is used. In implantation test, we can implant the strips either subcutaneously or intramuscularly by using hypodermic injection. For implantation of these strips, we have to use hypodermic injection. And these strips are implanted into paravertebral muscle. It is a muscle at the site of spinal cord. Then the opposite to that, we have to implant the control. High density control usually used here is high density polyethylene alloy, and we have to observe it for 120 hours. After that, in implantation test, what we do is that the rabbit or whatever animal we are using, we have to sacrifice that animal by giving the excess of anesthesia. And then the living tissue is removed from that animal, and we observe it under the stereoscopic microscope. And various reactions is then determined, and various codes are given depending on what observation we get. Like for erythema, ischia and edema formation, we observe the reaction. Erythema is the redness of the skin. Ischia is the condition where the dead tissues scrap out of the skin surfaces, and edema is swelling of the formulation. So various depending on the observation, like no erythema, we give score 0, very slight erythema 1, and so on, the scores are given for the sample. These are some of the images of ischia formation. First two are ischia formation, this is edema formation, and this is for erythema formation. So from observation we conclude that the sample passes the test only when the sample shows the less reactivity than the gland. What gland shows the reaction, like erythema, edema or whatever, sample should show less than the gland, then the sample will pass the test. This test is performed when we require the classification of plastic. Here in this table, the X indicates the test required for that class of plastic, and the procedure here indicates A is the systemic injection test, either IV or IP is intraperitoneal. B is intramuscular, intracutaneous test, and C is the implantation test. These are the various extraction medium which we use. These are specially that extraction medium I use, which we use as a vehicle for our drug. Like in the first case, A is the systemic injection test, intravenous. Here the dose given for the animal is 50 ml per kg, with the extraction. Now, extraction medium will use with sodium chloride injection, and it is applicable for all class of all class. These are the USP classification. Plastics are classified according to the USP. In USP, the classification of plastics is given. And so on, the various extraction medium are used and the various steps which are given. This all was about in vivo test. Now, in vitro, biological reactivity test in vivo, in vitro. So, in this test, we will observe the reactivity of mammalian cells on contact with the plastic or the other polymeric material. Even in this, there are three different methods carried out, like in vivo. That are other different tests, direct contact test and elution test. So, for performing this test, we will require cell culture, positive control and negative control and a sample. Cell culture is prepared by just taking a cell suspension and forming a monolayer into a plate of various diameters. Like in agar diffusion test, the diameter of the plate should be 60 mm. In direct contact test, it should be 35 mm. And in elution test, also it should be 35. Except exception of this agar diffusion test is that it should contain agar in their culture medium. Positive control always uses polyurethane film with the dihalocarbonate, and negative control is high density polyethylene alloy. Samples are used in agar diffusion test. We can use either the portions of the sample directly, or we have to extract it. Extracting. When we use the portions of the portions of that sample, it should be the flat surface. And in direct contact test, we will use only the portions of the sample what we are using. And in elution test, we have to use the extracts, especially with the sodium chloride, that is 0.9% sodium chloride. So procedure is that first we have to prepare the cell culture in the same way here what we discussed right now. Prepare the cell culture by incubation, then aspirate the cell culture medium, and then we have to replace it with the serum supplemented medium. The exception here is agar 2% only in the case of agar diffusion test. Then we have to place on that culture, we have to place the sample, positive control and a negative control. And then we have to incubate this culture at 24 hours at 37 degrees centigrade, 37 plus minus 1 degree centigrade, and examine this cell culture around for then after 24 hours we have to examine this cell culture for cell cultures around the positive control, negative control and the sample preparation under microscope. So there will be the various malformation or the cell degeneration. Cell degeneration, and this depending on what observation we get and what area we observe under the microscope, we will use several gates for the reactivity gates for that sample, like no detectable zone or malformed, that is zero, malformed or degenerated cell, we will give one and so on. Reactivity is given like none, light, mild, moderate, and severe. Also, that was for the reactivity grade for agar diffusion test. This is the reactivity grade for elution test in the same manner. So here, the sample passes the test only when it shows the grade less than 2 and less than 2. The culture here, to determine that whether our culture is defective or not, the positive control should show the grade 3 in all the tests. And the negative control should show the grade 2. This was all about biological reactivity test. There are various identification tests are also carried out, which is done by IR spectrum analysis and thermal analysis by DSC. Third is permeation test, like moisture permeation, water vapor transmission rate, and oxygen permeation is also determined prior to selection of the material. And light transmission is determined by spectrophotometry. These are the USP standards given for some of the plastics like polystyrene, high density polyethylene, low density polyethylene, and PET. For water vapor transmission and oxygen transmission. And the last test is the extractable test. We have to select the materials in such a way that shows the minimum leachable additive. we can do this test according to the USP. We can do this test extractables in hexane, alcohol, and water. Now,